Jananim Sharadam Devim Ramakrishnam Jagadgurum Padapadme Tayo Shritva Pranamami Muhurmuhu. Till now we have been hearing a very good discourse on the life and message of Sri Sarada Devi. And today is in a way thrice blessed day. Today is the Kalpataru day, today is Holy Mother's birthday, and today is also Roman New Year's day. So all the three have combined. So just now Vimurtanandji was telling you that Holy Mother's life shows us that not only Sri Ramakrishna was a Kalpataru, she was also a Kalpataru. In fact, Sri Ramakrishna's song is there. He sang in a song to Mother only, Divine Mother, and called her a Kalpataru. He called Mother as a Kalpataru. I am one Brada Tejavi, Kali Kalpataru Mule, he sang. Let come mine, let us go and wander near the Kalpataru, that is Kali. So he called Mother as Kalpataru. And our Mother Sarada Devi is none other than Kali, the Divya Shakti, Brahma Shakti. Therefore, certainly she is Kalpataru. And then, Mother, whenever they used to, many devotees used to ask her, when you read the Gospel of Holy Mother, it is both biographical and also her teachings. Both are there together, just like the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. The Gospel of the Holy Mother, people ask every type of question to her, and with what patience she answers. So one of the questions that was asked often was, Mother, why have you been left behind this time by this avatar of this age, Sri Ramakrishna? In all the other ages, so Krishna lived beyond Rukmini and Satyabhama and others. And in Rama also lived beyond. Sita had left the world, then only Rama left the world. But this time, Sri Ramakrishna has left you earlier than that. What is the meaning? She and Mother, in her own simplicity, there was no necessity for her to answer this question. It is, many times she used to say, it is his will. But she didn't say. She said, he wanted me to show the motherhood of God to the world. If God came to the world as a mother instead of a father, so Rama was a father, Krishna was a father, Jesus was a father, Muhammad was a father, Buddha was a father figure. So they are all called the avatars. Suppose in place of them, the mother was there, in the mother form God came, how he would behave with the devotees, with the jnanis, with the yogis, with the karma yogis. To show that to the world, the motherhood of God, the supreme love that God is, Sri Ramakrishna has left me behind. It is very true. As I often say, mother and father, both are equally loving. All of us have experienced it. We have experienced the love of our fathers also, love of our mothers also. So we have always thought both of them are equal. They may be equal at a later stage, but in the younger stage, you always love the mother more than father. Because you require mother's love, mother's care, mother's protection. She is always available. In the olden times, women did not go out to earn anything. There was no necessity to earn. This was an agricultural society, where there was enough of paddy and rice and dal and pulses and ghee and jaggery. Everything that you want, sweet, savory, you could do. You can eat, you don't have to go to office, both husband and wife. Husband also did not go to office and work, and wife also did not work. So mother was always found in the house. House means mother. That is why a Sanskrit proverb said, Na griham griham uchyate, grihini griham uchyate. The house is not, home is not called a home, but it is the homemaker that makes it a home. So homemaker, he makes the house a home. Otherwise it will be a house. It will be a building. So the necessity of a loving person 24 hours in a house is filled by the mother. So on mother we always get. So for any problem, it is mother who has attended to it. At least when we became 7 or 8 or 9 years, it was mother on for everything. Later on, we understood the necessity of father and his contribution to our life. So mother loves, father disciplines. We require both. A love without discipline, it becomes indulgence and children may go wrong, go wayward also, get spoiled. Our only discipline, children will always become morose, they will be dispirited and they cannot grow well. So we require both the mother's love as well as the father's discipline. So in this case of Holy Mother, we see this love manifesting in a very big way in the spiritual life. So you have already heard, we had a very beautiful spiritual discourse that Balaji Bhagavatar and the party, those of you who have attended it, you would have relished it. So he brought out so many incidents from Holy Mothers. One of the holy incident he brought out was, Sri Ramakrishna instructed all his direct disciples, who were all young people, Narendra, Rakal, Baburam, they were all young boys of 18 years, 19 years, 17 years. So these boys should not be given heavy food in the night. That was one of the rules of Sri Ramakrishna's Gurukul University. That was a Gurukul University where he prepared so many graduates and postgraduates who are instructing us today. So in his Gurukul University, one rule was that mother is the vice chancellor. So he is, Thakur is the chancellor. So mother is the vice chancellor who is managing the affair. He had asked this vice chancellor never give heavy food in the night. Why? They have to meditate in the night. Actually they used to meditate. It was not simply was telling. You read the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna. So there you find, you see it was 12 o'clock in the night. Sri Ramakrishna is talking to them. They are there in the room, these young fellows. There is no other outsider from society. The young fellows are 2, 3 are there. He is going on talking 12 o'clock night. So Master Mahasaya writes. And then he tells them, you go and meditate now. 12 o'clock in the night. And in another incident, Master Mahasaya, he would not sleep in the night. He came only to meditate and learn spiritual life from Sri Ramakrishna. So in the night, he leaves his room. It would be another Nahapath, second Nahapath. So he used to stay there. So he comes out at 12 o'clock or 12:30 and he moves about in that lonely place of Panchavati. Then he finds one young man is crying, Govinda, 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 loudly and crying for Govinda to appear before him. Sadhana is going on whole night. So Sri Ramakrishna instructed Holy Mother, don't feed them heavily, otherwise they will not be able to do sadhana whole night. Mother was mother. So Baburam once was being fed in the evening. She fed him as much as he wanted. Perhaps Sri Ramakrishna had instructed 4 chapatis for him. She fed 6 chapatis or 8 chapatis. And Baburam also ate. When mother is feeding, you never feel how much you are eating. We all know. Whenever there is Nilave, when there is a moonlight outside, it is all sort of rural houses. So mother would mix up all sambar sadam and then tair sadam, etc. Instead of making sit inside the house, she would ask all the children to come out. So we would come and sit around her. She would just all the mixed things, sambar sadam, tair sadam, she would give one after another, a little in our hands. We would eat, she would later on say, you fellows, you would sit, we eat only half of it when you sit inside. When I go on feeding you, eat double. The love of the mother. So Baburam felt the love of the mother. So he ate more than the 4 chapatis. Sri Ramakrishna was very vigilant. So he did not escape his eyes. So he asked Baba Ramaraj, how many chapatis did you eat? He told the truth. Then he was annoyed. What? I have asked her not to feed them heavily. She has fed them so heavily that their spiritual life may be affected. Call the Sarada Devi. Then they called her. Then Sri Ramakrishna asked her, did I not ask you to give him only 4 chapatis? Why did you give him more than that? I said, what does it matter if I have given him 2 extra chapatis? No. They have to do spiritual sadhana. They have to progress in spiritual life. It will affect their spiritual life. About spiritual life, you don't have to worry. I will take care of it. So that Bhagavata is telling, she is telling this one to Sri Ramakrishna, the avatar of the age. You don't have to take care of their spiritual life. I will take care. That means she is equal to Sri Ramakrishna in that power of releasing people from their bondage. She is the divine person herself, Supreme Lord Himself, come in the form of mother. That was her motherhood. And so many instances are there where she is, her love and compassion, which is the distinct feature of mother, it manifests itself. One old lady used to come and talk to her. Sri Ramakrishna noticed it one day. And then he told her, don't you know this lady? She is not a good lady. She is not a good character lady. Why do you talk to her? Then mother said, no. She talks only now, good things only, about spiritual things only. That's why I talk to her. Then, no, it is not good that you talk to her like that. Even then, her character was not good. Now I don't know how she is. It is not good that you talk. He went away. Next day he finds she is talking to the same lady. And Sri Ramakrishna was embarrassed. What is this? I tell her not to talk. Then he came and told her again. Did I not tell you not to speak? No, why do you worry about that one? She is talking good things only. That is the mother's love. Mother always feels that a boy today who may be naughty today, that does not mean all his life he will be naughty. In fact, most of the nasty children turned out to be very good children. So, the mother knows it. If a person is bad at some time, we need not bother about it. And she had that confidence that she can set right bad people also, bring them to the right. So, one big incident in this line, we have noticed one lady, she had committed really a big blunder in her life. And all people were shocked in society. Nobody would talk to her. She was in great grief. The whole society has in a way ostracized her. She was suffering mental anguish. Then somebody suggested, you go to Holy Mother, you will get peace. She started coming to Udbodhan. And mother, on the very first day, she gave her some soothing words. A lady who was ostracized by the whole society, practically had none in society, for her, mother spoke in such a compassionate and loving words. She was so much happy. Again, second day she came. And she was there with her for an hour or so. And mother went on pouring her compassion and love through her words. And this lady was again very much impressed by that. Third day also she came. But the other devotees are there around. They did not like it. Other devotees came and complained to mother. Mother, you know that lady, she is such a bad lady, whole society knows it. If you go on talking to her hours after hours and day by day, and we are all coming here also, people will suspect that we are also like that only. So we will be imputed with the same bad character. Then in that case, we may have to stop coming here, they said. Mother became very harsh. She said, what? You will stop coming from here. I don't mind it. So I am going to talk to her because she has nobody in society except me. Then she is coming here for solace. Do you think that I will send her away? I shall talk. I shall continue to talk. It is left to you. If you want to come, or you can come. If you don't want to come, you need not. All of them came. Nobody left. Because they had the touch of love of mother. They could not escape from that. All of them also came. That lady also came. Later on, that lady got reformed. So mother's compassion and love, it just goes beyond all sorts of calculation. Society may call you bad. God will not call you bad. Just like society calls a child bad. Do you think the mother and father accept it? They never. Always they think my son or my daughter is good. Only society is bad. They are looking bad at her. So this is the compassionate mother. She has showed it in several incidents in her life. And we see in mother what we want very badly in our present day life. The purity. Purity in our thoughts. The purity is mainly in thought only. So if we are pure in thoughts and feelings, the purity in the body becomes secondary. So bodily purity automatically comes. So the purity in thought, thinking noble about everybody, the main center of purity is to feel that we are all a member of a divine family. We are all children of God. Therefore, all of us are brothers and sisters. All of us are fathers and mothers. So a young man or a young woman must look at the world as the whole. They are brothers, they are sisters, they are fathers, they are mothers. This is purity. Mother was the personification of this pure outlook. She used to look at everybody, not only as brother, sister or father and mother. You remember when the Telo Bhelo robber came, she addressed him as father. A robber who comes to her to rob, she addresses him as, "Father, I have lost my way. I am going to your son-in-law's house. Can you please guide me?" It is something like Swami Akandananji. He was going to search Sri Ram Swami Vivekananda. Swami Vivekananda has gone in front of him, earlier than him, to some place. So he was going in search of him. People told him, "Don't go this via this Bhuj desert. There are a lot of dacoits are there. They may kill you for the sake of rupees one only. If you have got 1 rupee, they rob 1 rupee and kill you also, so that you may not go and complain. Don't go here, dangerous." But he made friends with dacoits themselves. And dacoits themselves gave him direction. And he went and saw Swamiji. So like that, this Holy Mother's eyes were so pure. The robber she called, "Father, Father." So she indicated through her life that we can have this pure look. Look at the world as your own, as a family of God. So everyone is yours. Everyone is your sister, everyone is a brother, everyone is a father, everyone is a mother. It saves so much of your mental energy and it gives you so much of internal strength, what you call as strength of purity, strength of holiness, strength of celibacy. So these are all terms different, but it means the same thing. Looking at the world as our own, we belong to the world. World belongs to us. There is nothing to fear about it. So similarly, we see in Sri Ram Holy Mother's life demonstrating this one with the Telo Bhelo and the great robber Amjad. Amjad used to consider her. She used to consider as her own son. She used to compare Amjad with Sarat Maharaj. So Sarat Maharaj also is my son. Similarly, Amjad also is my son. Not in the externals. Externals, he is a robber and he is a swami. But underlying that externals, there is an internal, which is always divine, which is pure, which is holy. It is to demonstrate that, to awaken that mother is there. So mother took Amjad as her own son. She was showed so much love to him. This robber, who was a terror to all the other villages, he never did anything bad in the whole of Garambati village. She said, because Holy Mother was like the police post, so her love was the police rules and regulation. So he could not bypass that and do anything wrong in Garambati. She used to call Amjad to repair her house. She had so much of confidence, she laid so much of confidence in him. He would not steal a single thing from her house. And she repaired her house very well. She also asked her perhaps relatives' house also. That also he repaired. So all the Jayarampati would look with wonder, how this mother is able to get work done so honestly, so sincerely through this robber. And the whole of Jayarampati was protected by her love. and this Amjad never touched. And Amjad was the Amjad only, he did not change very much. But with respect to mother and her surroundings, he had such great respect. Mother had that tremendous power of love. She would convert people through her love. And usually we associate with anybody who is loving with not much bravery. If somebody is very loving, we don't consider them as very brave. But mother was equally brave also. When circumstances demand, she could be very brave. As I have already told you, she could oppose her own husband. Yeah, when a husband says don't talk to her, she talks. When he said don't feed, she feeds. She knows it is my right. So my birthright nobody can take away. Let him be an husband. But he has got his own limit. My motherhood is my birthright. So I will exercise it in my own way. So she could be brave before her husband. And external bravery also she shows, which till today I have not been able to understand. You see, when Harish was there, Harish was the devotee of Sri Ramakrishna. Those of you who have read Sri Ramakrishna's life, he was a good devotee. He used to come quite often to Dakshineshwar. His wife did not like. The wife was perhaps a conservative lady. She thought he goes to Sri Ramakrishna quite often. Later on, he renounced the home and became a sannyasin, which she did not want. What was the solution she found out? She did some tantric rites against him. And the tantric rites spoiled his mind. So that fellow became a deranged in mind. So this madcap, he was roaming about in Calcutta. So once he went to Kamarpukur. That was the time when Holy Mother was there for about 1 year after Sri Ramakrishna's passing away. She was leading a very, very austere life there. So at that time, this Harish has presented himself in Kamarpukur. So mother once saw him. As soon as he saw mother, he has seen her mother in Dakshineshwar perhaps once or twice. So he started chasing her. Already he is mad. And he is chasing her. And there is no help at all for her. Perhaps all the villagers were busy in their own business, in their own duties elsewhere. She couldn't find anybody to help her. The only way was to escape from him. She started running. And he chases her. Then he showed a big barn of grass, dried grass, hay. She went round and round and round. 7 times she ran with full speed. And this fellow is pursuing her. Then mother says, I assume my own form. What she meant by it, we see. What we are assuming is her own form. Her form of Bagala. Bagala is one of the aspects of Dashamahavidya. She punished a demon, throwing him down and then just getting over his chest with her knee upon his chest. She pulls off his tongue and thrashes him on his cheeks. That fellow is punished like that and he runs away. She says, I became my own self. I assumed my real form, threw this Harish down and then just with my knee on his chest, I pulled out his drink and thrashed him on his cheek once, twice, thrice. He started gasping. Mother says, my hands became red by thrashing. But she was in a different mood. How she got so much of courage, bravery, dexterity. Our karate experts must be wondering how she could do it. So she could manifest her power, if necessary, like in the form of bravery, and face any situation. In fact, once one lady was wrongly apprehended as a culprit by the British police. So they made her walk a long distance to take her to the police station. When mother heard about this one, she became very excited. Her face became red. She remarked, were there no men to rescue that lady? They should have thrashed those police, whoever they are, and rescued that lady and brought her back. See the spirit. That is the heroic spirit. Mother was very brave and she would advise also brave solution. One of her disciples was running a school. So by the near the school, there was a family of Muslims in East Bengal. So, and those fellows, they used to cut the cows, so slaughter the cows. Once, you know, they brought the living animal and started flaying it, living animal, they started flaying a cow. That was too barbarous. So, all these people, they protested, they went and thrashed those Muslims and they ran away and they were so much pain. So, they wrote to mother, mother, like this, you know, we had to punish those fellows. They were flaying the cow before us. We could not stand it. Therefore, we thrashed them. So, they ran away, but they are now threatening us. They are going to finish us. They are going to take our life out. So, mother sent a reply to them. Yes, what you have done is right. If you could not protect that humble animal, ignorant animal, who else would? If God is true, you will get the justice. You, what you have done is right. Don't feel any repentance for it. And then they went to the court afterwards, complained to the judge, and the judge was wise enough to punish those fellows. The whole incident was stopped once and for all. See the advice of mother. What you have done is right. If you do not fight for the weak people, who else will do? It is one of the duties of human beings to protect the weak. And mother advised that and advised her disciples also to walk in that same way. And we do not know much about patriotism of mother. But there are incidents where she expresses her patriotism, the love for the country. Mother's time was one of the worst time for India, 1920s. She passed away in 1920. From 1900, practically, she was in charge of the Sangha, the Ramakrishna order, from 1886 to 1920, 34 years. 1886 was the beginning of the Indian National Congress and the starting of the national movement. So, national movement was being done against the British. So, Indians were being punished and tortured and put into jail, sent away to Andamans. All sorts of atrocities were going on. That was between 1886 to 1920. It was in top, in a high pitch. Mother had to see all this. Many people used to ask her, what about, you are helping us, we are all suffering for the country, what will Ramakrishna Mission do? And she is in the helm of affairs of Ramakrishna Mission. One lady comes and tells, you see, I am a householder lady, I am a housewife, so I have my duties at home. But earlier, before my marriage, I used to take part in this national movement. I used to help these national leaders who are all terrorists. They would go and then, if necessary, shoot out these British officers. So, I used to help them in my own way. Now, I have become a housewife. I am not able to do. But they are insisting that I should help them also. What is my duty now? I am a housewife. Should I attend to my household duty? Or should I help this patriotic movement? Mother said, you must do both. You must do both. If you are simply a householder, a housewife, that is not the end of it. The others are all struggling for the country. If the country is not all right, how will your house will be all right? So your house is part and parcel of the country. So you must contribute in your own way something to help this national movement also. See the tremendous advice, what patriotic feeling she must be having. Once some of our brahmacharis, especially in Kualpara, the small center near Jairambati. So they are all doing spinning charka. I don't know any of you have seen charka wheel or any of you know spinning charka wheel. We have all done it. We have spun our own yarn. We have got our own yarn woven into cloth. We have worn that cloth khadi ourselves. So, as young people, 1940s, that means 70 years back, 75 years back, when we are young people, so this charka movement was there. Charka movement was a symbol of economic independence. The Britain had made the India economic slave. They were destroying all our industries. and they wanted to push their manufactured goods upon us. It was a protest against that. So this Charkha movement had been taken up in a big way by the Swadeshi movement, the struggle for independence. So our ashram brahmacharis and sadhus were also spinning charkha and getting khadi made. They were all wearing khadi. So she went, when she went and saw the brahmacharis of Kalpataru ashrama spinning charkha, she said, "You give me also a charkha, I will also spin." She also wanted to contribute to the national movement. And then she advised him further. "You see, it is not the charkha that is going to give you freedom. It is your feeling for the other people, feeling for the neighbors, feeling for the countrymen, that is going to bring out the unity. Unity becomes strength, and the strength of a 30 crores of nation is terrible before small a few thousands of these white people. They will have to run away. Therefore, it is the means to unite people. So you must love people, you must serve people. Go and serve the people in your own way. Educate them. Give them, if they are hungry, food. If they are naked, give them cloth to wear." So helping the poor is the real way of national movement, not simply sloganeering, going on repeating slogans. It does not help in any way. All this patriotic advice she gives, and she asks, "You give me charkha, I will just spin." It's a great thing. So her patriotic feelings was there on one side, and another side, her love for women's progress. This is the main point in her life. The main thing Sri Ramakrishna also perhaps meant, what he wanted from her, was the awakening of the women power. Because Swami Sri Ramakrishna knew that however much ideals he must tell, so women folk will not be so much enthused. "Oh, he was a man, he was a great Paramahamsa, it is all true." Just like Shankaracharya, Madhvacharya, Ramanujacharya. "Oh, they are sannyasins, they can do all that, they can say. But we as women, we cannot follow 100%. So Sri Ramakrishna knew this. That is why he had two apostles for him, next to him, to carry on his banner of the establishment of new religion. Two apostles. One was for men and young men, Swami Vivekananda. For women, Holy Mother, mainly. Both of them, they meant both men and women. But Holy Mother teachings were more addressed to women than to men. Swamiji's teachings were addressed more to men than to women. Though both were involved in both of their mission. So Holy Mother wanted this progress of women. In how many ways she has encouraged our women. After Holy Mother, our women folk have never been the same old women who were at that time. At that time, women had so many disabilities. So Holy Mother herself has experienced, just because she put on a bangle on her head, on her hands, or just she put on a sari with a thin red border, the society could not bear with it. "Huh? She is a widow, how can she wear?" What does it matter? A woman wears a thin border sari. You may all laugh today, but that was a serious offense at that time. Whole society would throw her out. So that condition, she is advising women to say, some our Madrasi girls, she came to Madras. Our Chennai mutt can be very proud. She has visited perhaps 50 to 60 times her Chennai mutt from her house right in front of us. There was one NCC bank there. Now that bank building is not there. So it has gone out and another building has come up. So when I came 20 years back also, I saw that NCC building there. There was another bungalow where Holy Mother stayed across the road. And she used to come, Ramakrishnanji was not there, Sarvananji was there. He used, Holy Mother used to come here in 1911. Perhaps every day she used to come here, perhaps worship Sri Ramakrishna or offer Argya to Sri Ramakrishna and invite the Swamis to her house. They would go and take food cooked by Mother herself. So 50 to 60 times she must have come to this house, where you will find now Swami Ramakrishnanandji's statue. Just on the other side, there is another sort of a mandapam. There we have written, here this place has been visited by Holy Mother. So 50 to 60 times her feet has fallen here. She has worshipped Sri Ramakrishna in this. So there, when she was staying, so many women went and met her. So many. So among them, some girls were there, school-going girls. So they went to her, and they did not know Bengali. She did not know English or Tamil. So she wants to talk. Of course, with her, one or two Ramlal relatives were there. So they knew English and Bengali. And so she used to use them as interpreters. So when she found these Madrasi girls speaking English, she was very happy. You see, so much of prejudice was there against English. Even as late as 1970s, when I was in Bombay, I read out a welcome to a group of pandits in English. They were furious with me. What? Being a Hindu sannyasi, you are inviting us or welcoming us in English language. Could you not have done it in Hindi? Could you not have done it? They were furious in 1970s. So she is in 1911, 60 years back. She looks at these girls of Madras speaking English. She feels very happy. She doesn't feel disgusted, nor does she feel any enmity with the language. Because later on she is going to tell, those Englishmen are also my children only. I cannot go against them. The Swadeshi movement was going on. Everybody said, you boycott the foreign goods. He said, you may boycott, I cannot boycott. They are also my children. This was the large heart. So when she heard this Madrasi girl speaking English, she was very happy. And she told them, oh, they are speaking English. And she asked her interpreters, you ask them, so what would they say? So where will you go now from here? So they told it in English. Oh, she was very happy. Again she asked another sentence in Bengali. That was day he asked her. So she asked you to translate. So what will you do in your house? So they told it in English. After hearing it, she had such a good opinion about Madras. In that time, Madras means the whole of Tamil Nadu. So she is the whole of South. So all the South Indians were called Madrasis. In the North, up to very recently. So Madrasi means he is from South. Whether it is Andhra, or Tamilian, or Kerala, or Karnataka, all are Madrasis. So she says, Madrasi girls are very educated. So all of them can speak English, she used to tell. And then she asked the girls also, can you sing? So they said, yes, we can sing. They sang one or two songs. Said all the Madrasi girls can sing also. So later on when she was there in Calcutta, in perhaps 1910, so Sister Nivedita had started the school at that time. Then some Madrasi girls went there. As soon as she saw them, do you know English? Yeah, asked those girls. Again she repeated the same thing, you tell me what you tell in English. And then after hearing their English, she remarked, that's a great thing which we have to note, the intention behind her, that our women should learn English. What was the intention behind that? Not that they should learn English and then go to America with green card or blue card and then settle down there never to come back. Not that. What she wanted was, she tells, you see, all you young women should learn English, because in future thousands and thousands of foreigners are going to come to India as disciples, as admirers of Sri Ramakrishna and me and every direct disciples. So they should be instructed about Indian culture and life of Sri Ramakrishna and life of us. Who will do it? So you must all, you women must be ready to receive them and then explain to them the glory of Indian culture. See the vision of mother, she did not know a word of English. But she knows the use, the importance of an international language. Swami Vivekananda wrote in his rules for mutt rules that English must be taught along with Sanskrit, along with vernacular, English must be taught an international language. If Swamiji had not spoken in English in Chicago, would he have created an impact? if he had spoken in Bengali and it was translated into English by somebody else, would you think sisters and brothers of America would have produced a revolution? It is his very words in English, directly from the mouth of a God-realized soul. A son who has touched the feet of God, that inspired the whole nation, turned the whole history of the thinking world at that time. So he said that we must have hold on this international language. Now everybody is learning. The Japan till the other day, they did not learn English. Even today they say in Japan there is a good dictionary from English to Japanese or Japanese to English. One dictionary was produced a few years back in our Indian Institute of Culture by a Japanese scholar that was costing 12,000 rupees, one dictionary. Because it is rare, some with great difficulty has produced. So they did not care to learn international language. China, even today, our doctors, when they go to China, they find it difficult to diagnose the student because they don't know English at all. They hate. At that time, mother is telling, this international language you should learn because our mission is an international mission. It is a national mission, it is an international mission. We must keep hold on this international language. She wants the girls to learn English and so that they can spread the Indian glory everywhere. Then he, Gaurdasi, had started school for women, school for young women. Gaurdasi, Gauri Mata, disciple of Holy Sri Ramakrishna. And mother used to encourage her in every way. She goes to the extent, Gaurdasi, she is serving hundreds and hundreds of women through her school. This is her last birth. She will get salvation, highest salvation through this good work. That is how she encourages. And she used to quite often visit Nivedita school. Sometimes when Radhu used to feel very bad in the rented house where she was staying, she would go to Nivedita school and stay with Radhu. There were some spacious rooms there, some conveniences were there. Well, there is a very jocular incident about it. One day, this Bhudev was one of her nephews, Holy Mother's nephews. So this Bhudev was a small boy of 3 years old. But this fellow was very, very intelligent. So he would go to Sharat Maharaj and he would talk everything. He would call Sharat Maharaj Red Uncle because he was wearing red cloth. So he was called Red Uncle. So one day he went to Red Uncle. At that time, Holy Mother was staying in Nivedita school with Radhu. Then his mother was Nalini, Nalini's son Bhudev. So Nalini was with that Bhudev. Then he felt somehow he must ask Sharat Maharaj. He showed his mother, Nalini. You see, my mother Nalini is here. Where is your mother? See the strange question by a 3-year-old boy. So Sharat Maharaj, naturally he said, he showed Nalini herself. Then, she is my mother. That 3-year-old boy said, no, she is my mother. Your mother is in Sister Nivedita school. See, so she was the mother to everyone. This 3-year-old fellow knows. So this Sister Nivedita, how much she used to encourage. Sister Nivedita, this is her last birth. She has given so much of sacrifice for the country. Such a pure woman, like a devta, like an angel, she always is there. This is her last birth. So mother encourages everyone who works for women's upliftment. Then she expresses a desire that there should be a nunnery. There should be a nunnery for women as there is a monastery for the Ramakrishna Mission Swamis. This is not publicized much, that mother has her approval for a nunnery. They did not know. Very recently, they found from Sharat Maharaj's correspondence with the Holy Bull, Sharat Maharaj writes, with so much of persuasion, mother has given her opinion that there should be a nunnery for women. See the revolutionary thought. Nunnery was not there in Buddhism. Nunnery was not there in Christianity. That means for the last 4,000 years there was no nunnery. And she is thinking in a revolution. So 4,000-year-old history, she wants to upturn. And then she gave this revolutionary idea. There should be nunnery. When this was heard by Swamiji, he was so much encouraged. He already had an idea that I would start a nunnery for women first, afterwards a monastery for the children of Sri Ram, boys of Sri Ram Krishna. So he was already in favor of a nunnery, and mother's exhortation and encouragement made it very quick. And of course it took about 50 years. Then Radhu was about 14 years old. In those times, they would think of marriage of a girl when she was 8 years old. So at she is 14 years, she is going to missionary school and she is studying. So all the other ladies in her own household, Golapma and other people, they are telling, now Radhu has become old, she should not be sent to school. Let us stop her. Then mother pleads for Radhu. Radhu starts weeping. Then mother supports Radhu, saying, No, she is not old, she is only 14, let her go to school. What revolutionary mind she had. She was too far ahead of her times. Whenever the idea of upliftment of women came, and later on the Sharda Mutt, the very first president of that Mutt, was trained by her under very bad circumstances. As I have already told, in 1960s, when I was in Delhi, one of the educated girls of our devotee, she wanted to become a nurse. She said, no, nursing is not for women. No educated girl would go to nursing. They would come to know it is below the dignity. In 1960s, and mother in 1911, 1912, so she is encouraging Parul, later on who became Bharati Prana, to learn nursing under a white doctor. She became one of the best trained nurses. Later on she nursed mother herself for the last 2-3 years so dedicatedly. Then mother blessed her. She wanted to leave the world along with mother. One day this Parul, or she was renamed by to hide her name. So she was, her name was Parul. Then, later on she became Bharati Prana. She says, mother, you want to go away? I know you have decided to leave the world. I don't want to be here also. I have been serving you for the last 3 years. I will also, take me also along with you. This young lady. Mother says, yes, certainly you will come. You will come to me, but not now. I have got a small work to be done by you. You do that and come. What is that small work? Small work is to become the president, first president of the Sharda Mutt, a revolutionary organization which has created problems for all the other nunneries in the world. So the Buddhist nunneries are there, the Christian nunneries are there. All those nunneries are controlled by the monasteries. But this nunnery is independent by itself. So all the other nunneries are complaining, why we should be under the monasteries? Those fellows can manage themselves, can we not? We can certainly. So there is a revolution going on in other parts of the world. Nobody can stop. Mother has set the fire at the root. It is going to burn all this superstition. So everywhere there will be independent nuns. So they will work out their own salvation. That was a great slogan of Swami Vivekananda. Somebody asked her, so what do you think about the widow problem? He said, am I a widow? You are coming to me and asking me this question? So women will solve their own problem. They can solve in a much better way their problem than you men can do. Do hands off. They will solve, only educate them, give them freedom to work in their own way. They will solve their own problems. Indian women are equal to any women in the world. That was Swamiji's faith, and that was mother's faith also. So mother gave her all encouragement for the Sharda Mutt. So, and lastly we will close. We have already gone beyond our time. She is the guru of the gurus. Guru Naam Guru. So Shuka was called Guru Naam Guru. He is Guru of the Gurus. Our Sri Ramakrishna was Guru Maharaj. So he is Guru of the Gurus. All the Gurus are ordinarily they can liberate one or two or three or four people. Our Guru Maharaj has liberated numberless during his time and numberless beyond his time. His very name is liberating. So he is called the Guru of the Gurus. And Sarada Devi was a Guru of the Gurus. So Sarada Nandiji, who was her attendant all through her life, so he at once, you know, he doubted the mantra that mother gave. So one candidate went, and mother, after giving him mantra, he told the other things, how this mantra is to be counted on the fingers, on the japmala or on the fingers, to learn from Sharat. She sent him down. So he came down, and then to learn about how to repeat the japa on the hand or with the beads. But somehow or other, Sharat Maharaj asked him about what mantra you have received. He told the mantra. When he told the mantra, Sharat Maharaj got doubt. This mantra does not look proper. It is not complete. That's what he thought. He said, I think it is not complete. Something is missing. Why don't you go and check it up again with mother? So this initiated person went there. He went and asked the mother. Mother asked, why did you come? Sharat Maharaj sent me. That mother, the mantra seems to be a little incomplete. So you please see and then let me know whether it is right. So mother, after you repeat the mantra, then she heard the mantra. It's all right, you go. It's perfectly all right. He came down. Again, Sarada Maharaj could not believe it is complete. Again, he sent him back. So second time when he sent him back, second time also mother sent him back. It is all right. Third time when Sarada Maharaj sent, then mother remarks, what does Sarat know about mantra? This Sarat Maharaj, who is a knower of Brahman, he speaks to Sri Ramakrishna. In one place he says, I have to meditate for 15 minutes to come into contact with Sri Ramakrishna. He tells me whom I should initiate, how I should initiate with what mantra. This is Sarat Maharaj. To such a man, she is telling, what does he know about the mantra? You tell him it is all right. He need not bother about the mantra. Let him teach only how you have to count on the fingers and the beads. So Sarat Maharaj, even then he was not satisfied. But this admonition from her frightened him. He didn't send him back. And after mother's passing away, Sarat Maharaj came across some text, a tantric, authentic text, where that mantra was there. So he says, I cannot imagine what a prodigious knowledge of spirituality she had. Nobody could fathom her depth. That is why Sarat Maharaj used to say, I have been living with her for the last 20 years or more. I have never seen a deeper mind than that. I never hope to see also. Because it is God's mind itself. Who can fathom the depth? So, another one incident of this Guru of the Gurus, we shall close. One disciple of Swami Brahmanandaji, he was staying in Jayaramwati. He was a brahmachari. So he used to come late to his breakfast. So Holy Mother used to ask him, all the other brahmacharis come at the right time for the breakfast, why do you come late? Then this brahmachari says, Mother, so you know I have been initiated by Brahmanandaji. So Brahmanandaji asked me to repeat so many thousands times the mantra. So until I finish the whole thing, I should not get up and come for doing any other work. If I get up in between, then whatever I have done, half, that will be eaten away by the Rakshasa. The demon will eat away all that mantra. I have to start again from beginning. Again that whole number I have to do. So for fear of that one, I don't get up. When this breakfast bell goes here, I might have finished about 3/4. So another 1/4 I finish, and then I finish and then only come. That's why I am late. Then mother laughed and then said, no, it is not that. No Rakshasa will eat away your mantra. Be sure about it. Whatever you have done, that will be there. You come here at the right time and take breakfast. go back and finish the remaining one. What Rakal meant was that you should be dedicated to your japa. So you should not just for flimsy reasons get up in between and go. So unless there is very, very pressing thing, you should not leave your japa. That's what he meant. Don't worry about Brahmananda Swami. You come at the right time and take. See, Brahmananda Swami's disciple. So she just corrects Brahmananda's instruction. When Brahmananda must have heard about it, he must have felt glad that he has been corrected by mother. Mother's love. Mother's love. So this is how in mother we see all the facets of spiritual life. As a guru, guru of the guru, as a person who works for the upliftment of women, as a person who loves and shows compassion to everyone, whether meritorious or non-meritorious. On the whole, she is the embodiment of the motherhood of God. All the fine qualities, gentleness, purity, divinity, spiritual power, forbearance, patience, love, service, all this embodied in this. That is how Sri Ramakrishna left her behind, to manifest the motherhood of God. We see motherhood in the glorious form in mother. So all of us, let us take shelter under her. So whether Sri Ramakrishna is pleased with us or not, we need not worry. She will take care of it. Let us take refuge under mother, and our progress is sure, our salvation is sure, our sadhanas will become fruitful, that is also sure. So let mother bless us all. That is my prayer to her. Niranjanam nityamanantarupam bhaktanukampadrita vigraham vai ishavataram paramechamidyam tam ramakrishnam shirasanamama tam sharadam shirasanamama.